Thanks. Let me say something about the subject of today. But I will try to concentrate myself in one field, right about the field, that is the international trade system. And I would say perhaps that we should clarify what are we talking about. Because if we talk about the international trade system, we are not talking only on how to preserve multilateralism. We are talking about what to preserve, what was the essence of the multilateral trade system when it was established at the end of the war. And what was the key element was to have a rule-oriented, global multilateral trade system. That implied to have one global multilateral trade system. As we are familiar with soccer, we know what that means to define what is soccer according to the rules and to play according to the rules. And we can also ask ourselves if we would be prepared as a country, as a child, to play soccer without rules or the rules defined in each occasion by one protagonist. The main idea in 1947, when GATT was established, was to have one system of rules, at least with respect to the countries that were accepting to be part of the system. One system of rules in which there was one key element that was Article 1st of GATT, the principle of non-discrimination. That implied that we must, all of us, play according to the same rules in terms of how to apply tariff, etc., to goods and services that come from abroad. That was the main thing. And the rules of the system established also exceptions, but particularly how you could eventually apply different rules to other countries. That exception was established in Article 24 of GATT, that as every Anglo-Saxon written text was full of difficulties to interpret what are you talking about when you talk about free trade area or custom union. And we can say, because it was mentioned here, the idea of the eventual agreement, free trade agreement, inter-regional agreement between the European Union and Mercosur. Perhaps one of the main difficulties is the way in which, perhaps, I'm not saying, but only then, that our friends in Brussels interpret what is a free trade area in a very dogmatic way, without the lack of flexibility that you need to have, and particularly today in international trade. That is only a marginal comment. In any case, it was established one system, global, of rules, with the principle of non-discrimination as a key element of the system, and something very important in this kind of situation. Again, soccer helps us to establish some kind of, well, answer the question, what happens if one country doesn't apply the rules, conforming to the rules, separatism, etc. That was established in a very simple way in GATT, and then it was developed in the case of the WTO. Well, now, here we have a problem, because there are countries that are saying that system is obsolete. The main problem is that the country that is saying this That system is obsolete. It's the country that was the founding father of the system. Because in some way they were taking in the correct way, in my opinion, the lesson of the 20 years that preceded the definition of ghetto. That was in some way the fact that there was not a system, there was not a rule-oriented system, in some way had some contribution to what was the result of the evolution of that years that is called war. Some days ago, the Minister of Foreign Trade of G20 in Mar del Plata accepted the idea of the need to adapt the system to new realities. It was a way to recognize that what has been said by high-level people in some of the countries of the WTO were correct. The system is old, it's old-fashioned, it's obsolete. We need to adapt it. And that was agreed in Mar del Plata. Now, the problem is how to adapt the system. If any of you, any of us, read the articles in the WTO concerning how to change the rules, you will have a clear idea that it's very difficult, if not impossible, to change the rules if you don't have an agreement among 164 countries. That is something very, very difficult. So you must work with the idea that perhaps you will never obtain the necessary consensus to change the rules. And that is part of a political reality, it's not only an economic problem, it's not only a legal problem, it's a political reality that we are facing and that will be faced by the 20 members of the G20 when they meet here in Buenos Aires at the end of November. They must say something about how to adapt the system. At the same time, it's quite clear, and everyone agrees, that G20 is not the forum to change, but to negotiate new rules. That should be done in WTO, for example. But at least G20 is the forum to recognize we have a problem. And we have a serious problem if we don't solve the issue of which are the rules of the international global system. There are several possibilities. The first one is not to change nothing and to continue to perceive the situation of an international trade that is increasing global, connected among countries with a different reality of power that they had in the beginning of the system. That do not agree which are the rules of how to do it. Normally, you will have the same experience you have with children when you are trying to define what you see that night in TV. Finally, they will fight or they will fight with you. They will fight. If you don't apply rules, you finish fighting. That is something no new international relation. It would be naive to think that we could change the world in the sense that if we don't agree, we don't fight. There is another possibility, that is to develop a parallel system. And the parallel system would eventually, in my opinion at least, here I am as a provocator, it would be as serious as to have no system or to have only a parallel system. Why? Because if you have a parallel system and it pretends to be a global system, that means you send the message there is not only one global system, we have two, eventually three, eventually four global systems, so you have several plurilateral systems. We are talking now about plurilateral agreements as an alternative to the multilateral global system that has some problem that has been recognized, at least in the Mar del Plata meeting. Well, we could say, yes, that is a possibility, but it's a real possibility. I think yes, and you could ask me, well, can you give me an example of why are you saying that that is a possibility? Well, I was reading last night the list of plurilateral agreements within WTO. You have bilateral agreements, normally according to Article 24 and broad definition of what is a free trade agreement. Bilateral agreements, you have regional agreements. Regional agreement, you have a key element. You have the experience in Europe. There are countries that are linked physically in the same geographic region. Most, if not all, I would say, all the regional agreements are regional from a geographic point of view. And plurilateral agreement is a definition a little bit more larger, difficult to precise. What are we talking about when we say plurilateral? Several members, well, that could be multilateral also. And then you find one example. And curiously, is an example that is today in the newspapers. That is an example of TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership. You could say, well, that is a plurilateral agreement, yes, but it's regional, because say Pacific, oh well, yes, Pacific. You could say Europe, yeah. And then you must do what normally we the lawyers try to do, is read, to read some articles, and to find in text that nobody reads, sometimes because I'm secret, until the moment in which I publish. And once they are published, nobody reads what has been said in that article. And I was really very much surprised one day that I read in the newspaper that United Kingdom was thinking to become a member of TPP. And I recall what I observed when I read, finally, the text of TPP. And then I realized that I was observing something that in some way was anticipating future. And that was the possibility that eventually any country that requests to be member of TPP can be member of TPP. And then I realized that we were facing the possibility of a parallel global system of international trade. And then I realized that we could have a problem. A problem if we are not member of the parallel system. And a problem if we are member of the parallel system and the countries that are not member of the parallel system, then some of that country could be very, very, very big also. It could be annoying because we have fragmented the international trade system. I am referring of Article 4, Chapter 30 of TPP. The original version and the new version of TPP. That version that has raised the possibility, possible scenario, of return of the United States to be member of TPP. And that article says very clearly any country could be member of TPP. It must be requested and it must be accepted by the members of TPP, the original members of TPP. That produces a reaction in the sense where we are facing eventually a serious problem of fragmentation of the international trade system. I finish here. But I must mention something else. I must mention what I read in the newspaper this morning. El País, newspaper that you can read it at 6 o'clock in the morning here in Buenos Aires. El País, in page 5, says that the United States could veto the trade treaties on Canada or or Mexico with China. A very, very small article in the chapter 32 that is recognized, that nobody has read that article, that say that eventually you could say, if you sign something with China, you go away or I will go away from this club. And finally, thanks to the situation today in the European Union, England, etc., we can observe the problem that could have a country that decides not to be a member of the club, to go away from the club. Where do you go?